Welcome to all our visitors, and welcome if you're watching online. I know Ponce and Carol are watching, so miss you guys. Hope you're having a great time. We'll see you soon. And you know, I don't know if you've ever noticed, but I don't always do it, but I like to. In the hymnal, if you look at the top of the page above the title, it always has a scripture, which, you know, the hymn is based on. And today's was John 1:9, and it said, you know, that the true light was coming into the world. And we know that Jesus was the light of men, you know, and he had life in him. So shine, Jesus, shine. That's the only thing he could do. He's the light of the world. Amen. And so he just does what he does, and he is who he is, and he's the light of the world, and he's the light of men. So what a great song. Yeah, kiddos, you're dismissed with Miss Lise. Have a good time. All right, have fun. Well, if you guys want to bow your heads in prayer, and then we'll get into the word. Lord, do we just, we're rejoicing already, Lord, like every Sunday, reading in the Psalms, praying, Lord, giving you glory, lifting up needs, singing great songs to you, singing the hymns and worship songs. And so, Lord, we're just grateful to be gathered in your name. Now, Lord, will you touch each of our hearts by your Holy Spirit as we worship you by looking into your word and letting the Holy Spirit search our hearts, what we need to, you know, if we need to change, if we need to repent, if there's a promise we need to claim, an example we need to follow, Lord, a warning we need to heed, whatever it is, Lord, to speak to us this morning, we trust it to you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, well, we are continuing in the book of Hebrews. And we're in Hebrews chapter 12, and today we're going to go through the first 11 verses of Hebrews 12. So if you want to turn there and follow along, I'll go ahead and read it. Hebrews 12:1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. You have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin. And you have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as sons. My son, don't despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you're rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens, and scourges every son whom he receives. If you endure chastening, God deals with you as sons. For what son is there whom a father doesn't chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. And furthermore, we've all had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect. Shall we not much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? For they indeed for a few days chastened us as seemed best to them, but he for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. What a great passage from a great book. But we've been enjoying going through this whole book of Hebrews, and I'm sure you have been. I know I've been learning a lot and just being blessed by the word. Last week, we dug into verse 1 and the strategy that the writer laid out for us to have the endurance we'll need to successfully finish the race of faith, like all those who've preceded us. right, in chapter 11. And the writer describes him as a great cloud of witnesses, all those who had gone before. We are to lay aside and we are to put off. It's the same word, just translated in different ways, but it means the same thing. The sin that so easily entangles us, along with anything that the Holy Spirit would help us identify as a weight in our life. And weights are things that rob the valuable resources needed to accomplish the will of God and to complete the course marked out for us. And so, I'm wondering how your week went. I hope you had a good week, and maybe the Lord, I don't know, he might have put his finger on something that's a weight in your life. And, you know, hopefully you surrendered it to him and said, yeah, I'm not going to. The Lord says I need to lay this down and not take it with me because it's, you know, jeopardizes my completion. It zaps my endurance. But as we were talking about that, I don't think specifically I mentioned it about those things that God knows that will encumber us and weigh us down spiritually. But I was thinking again about those weights and then moving on. Though, as I mentioned, they're not sinful in and of themselves, one thing that makes them so dangerous is the amount of time they can consume in our lives. And so we talked about what's a weight. You know, a weight is, could be an interest, a pursuit, a hobby, a career. It could be a relationship. It could be a liberty. You know, whatever it is, something that the Holy Spirit identifies in your life that for you, I don't want you to participate in this because this is going to, you know, get in the way of you fulfilling your call. But I was thinking about it, not only that, it's the amount of time, you know, that it takes to pursue that, to be interested in it, in that, and, you know, develop that. And that time is very much needed in refueling the spiritual man in prayer and the Word of God. And so those things, how often, you know, after we've done our work and we've done our chores and we've done whatever, all the things we have to do with our, paid the bills, made dinner, put the kids to bed, pull the weeds, whatever we got to do, right? Refuel the car, blah, blah, blah. You know, but, and then it's like, oh, I want to, you know, do this and this. These are my things that I enjoy doing. They could be our entertainments. They could be whatever. But are we allowing those to squeeze out the time we need to be getting refueled by the Word of God and prayer? Because after we do that, then it's like, what's the priority? It can be the problem too. Are we prioritizing the things that will help us to have endurance? Or are we allowing the weights not only to bog us down, but to rob us of the time we need so we can be spiritually strong? So we've got to carve out, we've got to guard the necessary time in hearing from and talking with the Lord on a regular daily basis. You know, and it's during that time too that the Holy Spirit can identify and point out anything that's going to jeopardize our success. Things that we need to lay aside so that we can fight the good fight, run the race, keep the faith. As we read through our passage this morning, and even since he's developing a theme that he's been developing all the way from chapter 10, the end of chapter 10, through chapter 11, and now into 12, he continues. Did you notice a repeated theme that the writer has been emphasizing throughout this whole section? And what is the theme is a repeated key word that he uses over and over. Did you notice a word he kept repeating? No, not that one. Endurance. How many times does he say endurance? Just even, you know, in chapter 12. Hebrews 10:36 says, "For you have need of endurance, so that after you've done the will of God, you may receive the promise." So this word endurance, it means to remain under the challenges that God allots in life. To endure means to stay underneath, to remain under something while patiently waiting and persevering. And although endurance in the believer's life does take some true grit, you got to have some true grit to want to endure underneath these things. But the idea is not to grit one's teeth through the difficulties and the challenges. There's a big difference between having true grit and grit your teeth through something. But it's interesting because this word endurance, and it's from the Greek word, some of you have heard it, hupomone, is a root word for this endurance. But it means to cheerfully, which is not gritting your teeth, and patiently endure with hope. And that gives it a whole different meaning, right? An idea. Not like just to endure like, oh, I'm going to make it through. But actually to have some joy, some hope, and some cheerfulness. That's a completely different picture. And in verse 2, we're given the example of Jesus himself in enduring the shameful, the unpleasant, and the excruciating in accomplishing the will of God. Why did Jesus endure the cross? Why did he choose to bear it for us? Why did he stay underneath that burden? Well, the author tells us, right? Because of the joy. So we got the answer, that's nice. That was set before him, right? The joy of accomplishing salvation for all who would ever believe in the greatness of his sacrifice. The joy of becoming, as the writer puts it, the author and the finisher. The one who initiates and the one who perfects our faith. And as I was just sitting there thinking about that idea of Jesus enduring the cross for us, it reminded me of the song that goes, "When he was on the cross, I was on his mind." What a great lyric, right? And that's what the author says. He says, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. But while he was on the cross, you and me were on his mind. It was all for love that motivated him. And so as we run the race, Jesus had a race that was set before him. And he endured and he completed it. So as we run the race that's set before us, I want to pause here for a moment and just ask a question. Who marks out the course we are to run? We're to run the race, but do we mark it out? Does a runner mark out his own course if he shows up to compete? Or, you know, is their job just to compete and to run with endurance? They're not trained to lay out the course. They're trained to complete the course. You know, and what happens if a runner decides to run outside of the boundaries of the course? You're going along, maybe it's a long distance run, a marathon. You're like, oh man, another hill? Man, who laid this course out? This course stinks, man. It looks pretty steep. It looks pretty exhausting. I think I'll just go around this one. Well, what happens if the runner just takes a detour, does his own thing? Disqualification. You don't get to choose the course. You get to choose whether you're going to run with endurance or quit. I mean, that's your choice if you're a runner. And how about Jesus? He was the Son of God. I received from my Father. Do you see that? It was a command received from the Father. It wasn't what he thought he wanted to do. He didn't just create his course. He received a command to lay down his life and to take it up again. And that's what Isaiah said in Isaiah 53:10, talking about who laid out the course for Jesus to run. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He, that is, the Father, has put him, Jesus, to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, it was the Father's plan. He put the Son to grief. It pleased the Lord to bruise him. And quoting from Psalm 40, which just a couple chapters previous, the author cites Psalm 40, and he said, when the Son comes into the world in his incarnation, there's this discussion when he's leaving heaven, and they're talking about the eternal plan. There's a dialogue. When the Son comes into the world, this is what he says. Behold, I have come. In the volume of the book, it's written of me to do your will, O God, not my will. And in the Garden of Gethsemane was just before the home stretch. If you're running the race, you're coming down the straightaway, right? You've made the final turn. You're headed for the finish line. And what did Jesus say when he headed to the finish line when it got really tough? Not as I will, Father. Author and the finisher, that means they arrive at home in the eternal presence of God. That's the finish line for the Christian. And to be faithful along the way. And so the author is encouraging the readers, and by extension, he's encouraging each of us not only to follow in the example of the ancients who lived by faith, chapter 11, but also in the example of Christ, and run with endurance the race marked out for us, which is God's will in our lives. And as we do, as we're endeavoring to do that, what do you suppose are the three classic threats to us finishing the race? What are the three classic enemies of the Christian? The world, the flesh, and the devil. Those are the three classics, right? And so those are the classics to us completing the race. And the writer's already addressed, you know, out of those three, what do you think is most often our greatest enemy? The flesh. We, even as Christians, we're our own worst enemy. But he's addressed how to confront our worst enemy already. Verse 1. We're to put off the old man. That's laying aside. Which grows corrupt according to the deceitful lusts. And we must not allow any pursuit, interest, or passion squeeze out the spiritual in our lives and rob us of the power to run with endurance. And we must lay aside every weight. Notice he doesn't say, you got to get rid of most weights. But you can pick your top one or two favorite weights and strap them on your back. But beyond that, definitely make sure that you get rid of the rest. He doesn't just say lay aside the weights. He said lay aside every weight, every single one. And we talked about this last week. Any limitation or prohibition of the Spirit must be fully obeyed by the believer. If the Holy Spirit says, I prohibit that in your life, that's a weight that you have to lay aside. And that's the Spirit's prerogative to say, hey, I'm going to limit something or totally prohibit it for you. And if he's not Lord of all, he's not Lord at all. Is he the Lord of the things that you have to let go? Remember we talked about it? Isn't that what discipleship is? A denial of self to follow him on a daily, you know, path with him. And so does the Lord have the freedom to say what stays or goes in our life? Or do we, you know, have to demand our own way? We talked about that. It was a great and searching message. As far as taking care of, you know, personal enemy number one, the flesh, reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 6, that's Paul the Apostle. And therefore, don't let sin reign in your mortal body that you should obey in its lusts. Lay aside every weight. Lay aside every sin. And so now moving on, that's dealing with that first enemy, the flesh. Now moving on in verses 3 and 4, we're still examining the example of Jesus. The writer identifies what I'm going to combine as the two remaining enemies of going the distance and completing the race: the world and the devil. If you look there, verse 3. For consider him, that's Jesus, who endured such hostility from sinners against himself, lest you become weary and discouraged in your souls. Hostility from sinners. That's quite a phrase right there. The world and the devil working in combination in a perfect harmony to oppose the work and the will of God. That's hostility of sinners. In dealing with people who are openly and aggressively hostile to the gospel, we are directly coming up against the spirit of Antichrist at work in the world. And as I was thinking about, we could call it an unholy alliance between sinners and Satan, I was reminded that we don't wrestle against only flesh and blood. Not just mere flesh and blood as Christians, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Ephesians 6:12. So these aren't just these hostile sinners that are in opposition, those who oppose Jesus, those who oppose us. They're not just standalone in operation, are they? It's not just the ungodly coming against us, but the ungodly are under the influence and the control of the enemy, and some by far worse than others. The Apostle John, in 1 John 5:19, he tells us the whole world lies under the sway of the wicked one, under the influence. And so often these people aren't just operating in their own sinfulness, but they're being influenced and being compelled and being directed and being used to oppose. Consider him who endured such hostility from sinners against himself. How much hostility did Jesus endure against himself? He endured as much as wicked men could possibly pour out on him as he went to the cross. He experienced the full expression of both religious and secular man's hatred and ridicule and cruelty. If we look at it right, we know the story of Good Friday. We know the story of the rest of what Isaiah writes about, Isaiah 53, Psalm 22, what was prophesied would happen, which he perfectly fulfilled. And you see the extreme hatred, ridicule, and cruelty. There's about nothing more cruel or, you know, than what they did to Jesus. And yet, he remained constant. The idea of endurance that the author's talking about is being constant under the terrible burden of bearing the sins of the world. Not only was that horrible enough, he who was without sin became sin for us, right? So that was horrible enough, bearing all those sins, but it was also under crushing circumstances that he bore that until the debt we owed was paid in full. And so we're looking at the example of Jesus doing that and what it meant for him to do it and everything that was piled on top of him while he did that and accomplished that. And it makes me want to ask you, is the constant hostility of sinners in your life draining and discouraging you today? Do you have people in your life who drain you because they're hostile to the gospel, to your faith, and they oppose you? There's no doubt about it. It's a daily grind if you're in that situation, and it can wear you out. And you need to know it's a real spiritual battle that you're in the middle of. And if you, Lot's described as a righteous man who was sick of the shameful immorality of the wicked people around him. Yes, Lot was a righteous man who was tormented in his soul by the wickedness that he saw and heard day after day. And it is, if you're in that place, it is a torment to have to listen to all the ungodly stuff. Rick read about it. The stuff, you know, in our call to worship that David was talking about, these people that just, and in the New King James it says they belch out. In his it said, I don't know if it cleaned it up or not, but it said the filth that they spewed out their mouth. But mine said they just belch it out. They're like vomit on you. And it just gets tiring, and you get tired of it. You don't want to hear it no more. You don't want to see it no more. It's a torment for your soul. And just living among the ungodly day after day can make you weary, even apart from them being openly hostile towards you because of your faith and your stand for righteousness. And so I just want to say, and maybe you've experienced it, maybe you felt it, there's a great pressure to try to silence us as believers in Christ, to intimidate us, to try to get us to compromise and cave in, to not have a Bible study in your home, not preach Jesus with others, try to get you to shut your mouth and don't proclaim the good news. You guys feel it? You ever felt it? It's the spirit of Antichrist. That's what John calls it. That's what it is. It's all around us. Way back when he wrote 1 John, he said, the spirit of Antichrist, you heard was coming, is already here and it's at work. And it's never stopped working since then. And it's not going to go away until Christ returns. We're in a real spiritual battle for the souls of the men and the women and the children of our generation. Is there anyone trying to steal your children away from the Lord and try to influence them and pull them away and ridicule and mock the gospel? It's the spirit of Antichrist at work, and we're at war against it. And it takes stand up to it. And you can't grow weary. If we don't stand up against it, who's going to? And so what's the antidote to becoming weary and discouraged in our souls by all of this? Look unto Jesus. The author says, you look at Jesus, and I want you to think about, you consider, example, he effectively took quitting the race of faith because of either persecution or opposition off the table. Have you resisted to the point of laying down your life and striving against sin? The fact that you're in the room, I know you didn't, I haven't. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here for me to ask you that question, right? I haven't, you haven't, but Jesus did. That's what the author is saying. He endured unto the end. He gave it all to fulfill the mission. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Look unto Jesus. Look at his example. What did Jesus tell his disciples and tell us that was communicated to us through the writing of the Gospels? If the world hates you, you know that it hated me first. If you were of the world would love you. It would love its own. Yet because you're not of the world, I chose you out of the world. Therefore, the world hates you. Don't be fooled. The world hates you. If they persecuted me, they will persecute you. In light of all this, going back to Ephesians 6. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to what? To stand, which is the same idea of what? You may be able to endure. You can stand up against the wiles of the devil. How do we stand against the hostility of sinners who would wear us down? Where do we get the endurance that we need from? From the Lord and the power of his might. Isn't that encouraging? It's a lot to stand against. But I'm thankful because God, greater is he that is in you than the spirit of Antichrist at work in the world. He that is in the world opposing the gospel and every good thing and every work of God. But we don't have to try to be like, okay, I need to find some endurance even though I feel beat to a pulp. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. It's a work of the Spirit in our lives, the Holy Spirit. And now after talking about the need to maintain endurance in the face of hatred from sinners, as Christ did in fulfilling his mission, now the writer, these next few verses, he's going to shift gears a little bit now and talk about the need to endure God's chastening. But before we go through these last verses for the morning, let me ask you a question. How often do we treat this section of Scripture as a standalone text? We come to this and we're like, because it's a pretty familiar passage, right? But it's easy to overlook. Where does it lie in the context of the book of Hebrews? We can think, oh, okay, yeah, here's the passage. I remember this one about God's discipline and how it proves we're his children. That makes sense. Oh, yeah, this passage. God's my dad, so he spanks me when I get out of line. I remember this one. Which it does. It does say that, but how often do we... That's not the total context or meaning. But we fail to connect it to the... There's a continuing theme and thought progression of this letter. And our connecting word in verse 5 that joins what he's just said and with what he's about to say. In grammar, you call it a conjunction. It's a word that connects one thing to the next. It's and. And is a critical word right here. What does it mean? It's a continuing thought. He doesn't say, okay, now let me tell you something else. He's not just totally changing subjects. You notice and lies right between these two statements. Verse 4, you have not yet resisted to bloodshed, striving against sin, and let me tell you something else. You have forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as sons. So it's a continuing thought. You forgot the exhortation. What's the exhortation? Then he goes on, he quotes from Proverbs 3, 11 and 12. My son, don't despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you're rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. And so, if we follow the thought progression of the passage, After talking about setting aside every weight and the sin which would trip us up, and then looking unto Jesus, who is our example of patient endurance in the face of hatred from sinners, and he bore up under it, and he accomplished the will of God despite all spiritual attacks from sinful man and the spirit of Antichrist at work within them. Here's the question. Why talk about God's chastening of his children now? It's kind of an interesting question. You're talking about all this stuff. Lay aside the weights. Lay aside the sin. Look to Jesus and his example, you know, of how he endured against hostility of sinners, even to the shedding of his own blood, which you haven't done. And you've forgotten the exhortation. It's like, you know, about God's discipline. So what's the connection? What's going on? Well, what's the concern? What has he been addressing overall? He's been addressing God's people failing to run the race with endurance. Being tempted to drop out of the race because it's too hard. And I'm too worn out. I'm too tired. And they're too tired maybe, or could be the temptation because of personal sin. That'll make you not want to finish the race. Unnecessary weights that are dragging you down. The opposition, discouragement you feel, and the general weariness in your soul from all of that. And so in addition to everything that he's been talking about, that he's covered, what else might definitely discourage a believer in running the race if they fail to have a proper perspective, if they forget? The Lord's discipline. Think about everything that you're already going through, and then you're like, and now you have to pile on, Lord? I'm already, you know, can you see that? It's like, man, and now the Lord is disciplined. I'm undergoing discipline of God. Ironically, what's the very thing that brings on the Lord's discipline in the sense of correction?
Love.
No, say it again. Or let me say it again. What's the very thing that brings on the Lord's discipline? It is, he does do it out of love. In the sense of correction, how do we bring that on, the correction? Failure to deal with the flesh. We're failing to lay aside every weight and the sin, right? That trips us up. We're allowing ourselves to get tangled up in sin and not laying stuff aside as a disciple. And we're supposed to be running free of that stuff so that we can run with endurance. But if we won't obey in this, God will discipline us because he loves us, because he knows you guys won't complete the race. At the rate you're going, you'll never make it. The sin is going to kill you, man. It's going to wear you out. You won't make it. You won't last. This other stuff that you think you have to carry, that's so important, that you won't let go of, is actually draining you, preventing you, you know, squeezing out the time to spend alone with him and really get that strength in the inner man. And so God says, you're right, Brett. God says, because I love you, I'm not going to, as my child, I'm not going to allow you to fail. So I'm going to discipline you and help you to realize the things that need to go. But rather than take comfort, so if you're already in this frame of mind where you're sinning, you're got all these weights, you're beat up by the world, you're beat up by your own disobedience, rather than take comfort in that his discipline is an evidence of our sonship and his love for us, when we lose our perspective, it's just more discouragement. It's like, wow, now I'm being punished by the Lord. Right? It's a total loss of perspective. It's just like this downward spiral. But more than speaking of just correction, this word in some translations is chastening or discipline, whatever your word is, speaks of the training and education of children. This is kind of like the total of what is included. Instruction that brings someone to full development and maturity. So there's both the nurture and the admonition of the Lord involved in this discipline, in this chastening. And that would apply to any of us in Christ, since through him we have adoption into the family of God as children. So we're children of God through adoption. And so this chastening and this discipline would directly apply as we being children of God in that sense, that we need to be trained up, right? And as adults, this discipline is the thing that cultivates the soul, especially by correcting mistakes and curbing passions. Does the Lord's discipline in your life help curb passions that are not appropriate for a Christian? You're like, yeah, I don't think I should be involved in this. I know I shouldn't. And your discipline is really making me think twice. Yeah, I don't think I want to go down this road anymore. And so, if you endure chastening, right, God deals with you as sons. And this is just all really evident. He's just speaking about our human experience and then applying the spiritual to it, because everybody can relate. For what son is there whom a father doesn't chasten? Not too many. In general, fathers are wired to try to discipline and train their children, right? But if you're without chastening, of which we're all partakers, because he's writing to Christians, right? Talking about the Lord's correction, then you're illegitimate and you're not sons. So if you're like, yeah, God never corrects me, well, it's probably because you're not his child. You know what I mean? There's your big clue. God never spanks you because you don't belong to him. Furthermore, we've had human fathers who corrected us, and we paid them respect, right, as we should. So shouldn't we much more readily be in subjection to the Father of spirits and live? And so for a few days, they disciplined us as they thought was best. Basically, he's like, hey, man, we've all had dads, and they did the best they could. We all get it. They weren't perfect. They tried their best to try to get us launched in the right direction, to train us, to discipline us for the time they had. But he that is God for our profit, that we may be partakers of his holiness. Now, no chastening seems to be joyful for the present. Ever been, you know, disciplined and like, oh, this is such a great time. I just love this. I could just stay in this moment. No. It does not seem to be joyful for the present, but rather grievous. It's painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. I love how practical this whole section is. You know, basically in this, God knows what it takes to grow a mature Christian who can make it to the finish line. Right? We're not just looking for conversions or for numbers, but disciples, a true disciple who will follow, who will make it to the finish line. And so, it's so important to have the right perspective, especially if you're already feeling this opposition of the world, hostility from sinners. You know, you're having to lay aside the weights and the sins. Don't be discouraged if you feel like, man, on top of everything I have to deal with, I feel the Lord's breaking me or disciplining me. It's because he loves you and he wants you to make it to the finish line. And he's trying to train you and make you strong and give you what he knows you need to make it. I'm going to close with the words of a Petra song, Oldie But a Goodie, Second Wind. Listen to this and think about running the race. Long distance run from darkness, headed into the sun. And it seems like eternity till this race is won. soul and spirit weak and weary. Strength was almost gone when a soothing, gentle breeze carried me further on. I've got my second wind. Spirit's coming again. I've got a new revelation from the King of Kings. Found my second wind. Feel my strength returning again, returning again. Through a desert night in darkness, racing toward the light. There were too many hills to climb, too many battles to fight. Then distant lights were calling, beckoned me as a guest. When I found the oasis there, I entered into a rest. Just when I thought I couldn't run any longer, I got my second wind. Just when I thought I'd never be any stronger, I got my second wind. Just when I thought I would fall into darkness, I got my second wind. Just when I thought I would fail every test, I got my second wind. You know, and you ever feel like that? Like, man, there's too many hills to climb. There's too many battles to fight. I just don't know if I can make it. I just want to encourage you, you know, the Lord will be actively involved in your life to train and nurture and discipline and raise you up to give you the strength and everything you need to make it to the finish line. God is not going to let you fail as his child in the race. He didn't let any of these other guys, Hebrews 11, think about the hostility from sinners that they faced. Look at what Jesus faced. Look at all the hills they had to climb, all the battles. But they made it through, didn't they? And they obtained a good testimony by faith, the writer said. You know, and it seems like eternity till this race is won. Man, right? When you're in the middle of running a marathon, you're like, this is never going to end. I'm just not going to make it, right? But have you ever been going and you did get your second wind? It's like, man, just in the nick of time, I got my second wind. Well, the Lord, he knows how to do that. That's what the writer is saying. He's saying, be encouraged. You know, don't despise the chastening of the Lord. Don't be discouraged when you're rebuked by him. God loves you. That's why he's taking the time with you. He loves you so much. He loves you so much, he scourges every son whom he receives. It's like, wow, I don't know if I want you to love me that much. But, you know, the Lord knows what he's doing. He knows how to raise Christians that make it to the finish line. And that's what the writer is saying. You have need of endurance. And don't feel that's something you have to generate yourself. Reread through Ephesians 6 about the full armor of God. Be strong in the Lord. Finally, my brethren. You know, above all, stand. Stand fast. You know, in the Lord and the power of his might, let his Holy Spirit strengthen you. And you'll find the strength to do one more battle and climb another hill. God will breathe that life and second wind into you. So, I hope you're encouraged this morning because God, man, if God is for us, who could be against us? He's like, yeah, hello, it's a battle. It's not just pretty imagery or something like, oh, I can relate. I've seen a movie on battle or a war movie or something or an old gladiator movie or whatever. I saw Ben-Hur or whatever it is, you know. No, it's a real battle. And so it takes endurance to make it. But God has all the endurance that we need. But we need to not sabotage ourselves with being loaded down with weights, tripped up and tangled in sin. Of course we're gonna, and then on top of that, now someone hostile to the gospel is pounding us. You know, we feel like Lot tormented in our soul. Yeah, you're gonna feel like you can't make it, but throw all that stuff off. Walk with him daily, trust him by faith, and you'll find you're so much further down the road than you ever. How would you look at your Christian life? You're so much further than you ever thought you would be. You're like, man, I thought there were some things I wouldn't get through, but I got through them. And now I'm sitting here today, safe and sound, and he's going to take you safe all the way home. So, Steve, if you want to come up. But, you know, just respond to the Lord. Whatever You know whatever response he's speaking to your heart, and you just respond to that. You respond and you be strong, and next week he's going to keep going and say, hey, strengthen those weary hands, those knees. You're going to make it. You're going to be okay.
Take us away, brother.
Well, this kind of reminds me of a quote I read recently by a man called A.W. Tozer. He says, it's doubtful that God can bless a man or woman greatly until he has hurt them deeply, until he has disciplined them thoroughly, I'm adding this, until he has conquered them completely. It's doubtful that whether God can bless a man or a woman until he has conquered them completely. We're going to sing verse 2, Shine Jesus Shine. Lord, I come to your arms, some presence from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your kindness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine. Because of your discipline, because you're teaching us and training us, no matter how old we are, you're teaching and training us to have more of you to give to this world. We give you thanks, Lord, for this day. Thank you for this powerful word. We ask your blessing on these people, our people, us as we go. In Jesus' name, and everyone said amen.